Welcome to Economics class. Today we will learn about command economies. Command economies are the type of economic system used in communist countries. In this system, the economic decisions are made by the government. The government decides how to use scarce resources, what to produce, who to hire, and what prices to charge. The people have little or no influence over economic decisions. The concept of a command economy was created by a German philosopher named Karl Marx in his 1848 book, The Communist Manifesto. Marx lived in Europe during the Industrial Revolution, when a large percentage of the population living in cities worked in dangerous factories for low wages. A small class of very wealthy business owners made most of the decisions. Based on these factors, Marx predicted that there would be a revolution of the poor working class that would result in a communist society in which everyone's basic needs were met. Marx's economic theory stated that command economies would have the following characteristics. 1. The people, represented by the government, own all property and business. 2. The government decides who gets what resources in order to try and make sure that capital, labor, and other resources are used efficiently. 3. All people are provided with jobs by the government based on their skills. 4. Each person has their basic needs met, including food and shelter. And 5. The government owns major industries, so there is no competition, and creates laws that regulate economic activity. There are several examples of command economies in the world today, including China, Cuba, Laos, North Korea, Russia, and Vietnam. Today we will look at two examples, the former Soviet Union and Cuba, as well as some aspects of the United States that fall into this category. The former Soviet Union was the first command economy. For more than 70 years, the government controlled the production of all goods and services. They used 5-year plans to map out their goals and concentrated on massive building projects and collective farms. This resulted in human rights violations when citizens were forced to move and work on these projects against their will. Also, when the collective farms failed to produce enough food, the people suffered famine. As a result of economic and political struggles like these, the Soviet Union began to break apart in 1989. Cuba is a current example of a communist country. In 1959, Fidel Castro took over the Cuban government and implemented a command economy. He nationalized all foreign businesses and banks, as well as most of the nation's resources. To be nationalized, a business means to be owned and controlled by the government instead of a private individual. Castro also worked to diversify the Cuban economy. He felt they relied too heavily on producing sugar to ship to the United States, who was now boycotting them. So Cuba began producing coffee and citrus also. During the 1970s, Cuba and the Soviet Union began trading with each other. By the 1980s, the Soviet Union was investing $4 to $6 billion per year in the Cuban economy. When the Soviet Union collapsed in the early 90s, it severely damaged Cuba's economy. Since then, they have focused on opening up trade relations with other countries. Last, we will take a look at the United States. The United States is not a command economy, but it does exhibit a few characteristics of one. For example, the local, state, and national governments control about 1/3 of the economy. The government also regulates air pollution from vehicles and factories. The federal government gives subsidies, in other words, money, to farmers so that they can compete with farmers in other countries who also get government subsidies. However, Americans do have a voice in how their government regulates the economy, and they elect leaders to make the laws and policies they must then follow. Overall, command economies have advantages and disadvantages. An advantage is that leaders can set goals and direct the economy to meet these goals. Leaders can also make dramatic changes happen quickly. They can implement planned projects or programs on short notice. And all people have a job. No one is unemployed. A disadvantage of this system is that economic outcomes and opportunity costs are hard to predict. The system does not always meet consumer needs, and there can be shortages of goods. The system does not encourage new ideas or progress, and many people are needed to run the system, which can make it inefficient. There is little or no freedom in the type of jobs provided, and few choices of goods and services. Individual economic rights are lacking, which can lead to poverty and suffering.